battle belongs to you. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high, oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night, oh God, the battle belongs to you. When I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high, oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night, oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
So everybody knows we're going to do it in the key of C. We were debating, and it's going to be C.
Decision has been made.
They're like, so? Whoopity-doo. All right.
I was worshiping better.
Okay, because Debbie was worshiping better, we're going to do it in the key of C.
Because it was in the key of worship.
A is the key of worship.
Oh, we thought it was C.
Well, I sure don't worship in C.
It's F in worship.
Maybe you need to get saved, though.
Well, maybe Randy will preach an altar call today, and I'll think about it. All right. See it is. So.
Okay.
Hey, Randy, I'll read to you scripture. You were there in the valley of shadows.
Right at the beginning.
In the depth of my sorrow.
Okay, gotcha.
You're my strength, my hope.
Well, he's just.
For your goodness, I will ever praise you. Feeling lonely, this world got a way of showing me. Some days it'll lift you up, some days it'll call you bluff. Man, most of my days I ain't got enough. And all I know is you're my only hope.
I just need you
on my darkest day,
uh-huh.
When I'm losing faith.
Good morning. Welcome to worship here at First Baptist Church. We're excited to join together and to praise our Savior and our King. And as we do so, I just want to make one announcement. We really, really need people to volunteer for VBS. Not only would it be something that you're serving and doing well for the community, but it's also something that'll serve you as well as you join God in service to those around us in our community. And if you need help signing up, Kelly will help you after the worship service at our kiosk in the lower auditorium. As we gather, what prayer requests and praises do you have? And someone will come around with a mic, and if you could share your name and your prayer request and praise, we'd love to pray together for you.
Lewis came home on Friday, and he's doing well considering everything and grateful for everyone's prayers. Thank you.
Would anyone else like to share this morning? Will you join me in prayer? God, we are incredibly thankful for you. We're thankful for your presence in our lives. And as we gather this morning, Lord, we just pray that you would help us to trust you with the things we may be struggling with and to celebrate with you the things that are going well in our lives, giving you the glory and the praise for those things, believing and understanding that you are our creator, that you are our king, and that you have a plan and a purpose for each and every one of us. And so, Lord, as we gather together for worship this morning, we pray that you would help us to worship you beyond these walls, to worship you with every breath that we take as we follow you and live for you and live with you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Good morning. I'm reading from 1 John chapter 2, verses 9 through 11. Anyone who claims to be in the light but hates a brother or sister is still in the darkness. Anyone who loves their brother and sister lives in the light, and there is nothing in them to make them stumble. But anyone who hates a brother or sister is in the darkness and walks around in the darkness. They do not know where they are going because the darkness has blinded them.
Good morning. Good morning. As we worship together, we also recognize as we come together, it's Memorial Weekend. And for me, as I've continued to grow through the years, you know, when I was young, I didn't really understand much about Memorial Weekend. And for me as a kid, I remember it meant another Labor Day because Dad was off work and then we had to work a lot at home, cut firewood or whatever. So that was Memorial Day for me. And as I got older, I saw more meaning in that, and then I recognized my mom was putting flowers on graves during Memorial Day. And I just realized how that tradition didn't like run into me deeply because I was just dawning on me, oh, mom's gone now and all those relatives' graves aren't being decorated. You know, all the kids live out of state. And it kind of gave me a little sadness. And I realized how it was off my radar, because even a few weeks ago when I went down to my niece's wedding in Florida, I drove within like 3 or 4 miles of my parents' graves and my other family. And I thought, I could have done something then, but it just wasn't on my radar screen in April to think about that. So what I want to help us all have on our radar screen this morning is recognizing some of us have lost someone who's very dear to us recently. And at some of our homes, there are tables, you know, with that chair that's empty. And then others of us haven't had that loss, but maybe we've had another type of loss. But the really awesome thing is we come to worship together. We do so recognizing that we're all dealing with all sorts of different things in our lives and how the important thing is that as we face each trial or each point of grief in our family, that we recognize that our Savior is always there, arms wide open, loving us through that experience. And as we do so, I would like to just read through a list of names. And these are some of our folks who've passed on this past year, and it's not all inclusive, and I'll give you a chance if you want to share another name, feel free to do this, but this is some of our members. In 2020, we lost Joanne Goins, and she died on April 16th. We also lost Sue Ellen Voris. She died on October 21st. Chris Hassfurter, He died on October 29th. Mary Jo Goins died on November 11th. B. Rusk died on December 17th. And then this year, John Russell died on February 18th, and Harold Childress Jr. died on March 7th. Does anyone have any others that you want to add to that list? So we remember that, yes, in some of our families, there's an empty chair there. But as we come to worship this morning, we recognize that God's love is filling our hearts, and our memories of those are precious with all the saints who have gone on before us. So as we worship, let's do so with full hearts, being full of the love of God, no matter what's going on around us.
Thank you, Randy. Good morning, everyone. Happy Memorial Day to you. I think I would like to add a couple names to that list. Let's all stand as we prepare for worship. My dad lost his friend, David, a few weeks ago, a couple months ago, to COVID. My wife lost her aunt this past year due to COVID. And we, our good neighbors, Ron and Vangie Greaves, we lost them to COVID this year. And those are just ones that are coming to mind. I'm sure that I've left some out, and you have some as well. So yes, thank you, Randy, for bringing that to our attention. And let's just be, let's have a spirit of reverence today and be in prayer for those families. So right now, let's worship the Lord as we sing Never Let Go. You know, the first three, really the first four songs, I just kind of was thinking, they really speak to God's faithfulness. It's not really our work as we sing these songs of praise and adoration to God. We're not singing about what we do, you know. We're singing about what He does. And the first song, Never Let Go, it just talks about He's always there with us. And as we go through these times like today where we're sad and our hearts are broken, He's there with us, and He's with those families that have experienced loss.
Well, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, Your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know You are near, and I will fear no evil, for my God is my God is with me. Whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh, no, You never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh, no, You never let go in every high and every low. Oh, no, You never let go, Lord, You never let go of me. I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on, a glorious light beyond all compare. And there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, we'll live to know You're here on the earth, and I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. My God is with me. Whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh, no, You never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh, no, You never let go in every high and every low. Oh, no, You never let go, Lord, You never let go of me. Is coming for the heart that holds on. There will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise You, still I will praise You. I can see a light that is coming for the the heart that holds on, and there will be an end to these troubles. But until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. Oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. Never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me.
Are you grateful for that this morning, that he never lets go of us? Thank you, Lord.
All I see is the battle. You see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadows, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, well, you see the beauty. When all I see is a cross, God, you see the empty tomb. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, and I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, and I'll sing through the night. Oh, the battle belongs to you. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to tonight, oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, God. When the battle belongs to us, when we make it our battle, how does that turn out for us? Not so good.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies, and if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life, there's a better life. If you've got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We all run to things we know just ain't right. Well, there's a better life. There's a better life. And if you've got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you've got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. And if you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker. Oh, if you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker.
Your faithfulness. Your faithfulness that you never let go of us. And your faithfulness that when we find ourselves in bondage to our old life, the life that you went to the cross to deliver us from, but yet we fall back into it, you give us the ability through your Spirit and through your power to break those chains day after day after day. And we need never be in despair because you're always with us. And we thank you for that, God. And Father, as we think about this offering that we will at some point give today, I pray your blessing upon it now. And I pray that it's a representation of our intent with our whole life. as we practice with our finances to give a portion of what you've given 100% of to us, we give back to you a percentage showing our trust in you, our reliance upon you. I pray that that really is just one thing out of our whole life. I pray that our whole life is lived that way. But instead, we give our whole life to you, knowing that we can trust you with it, and you're going to take it and make it something powerful for your kingdom. As you don't let go of us, help us to let go of us and to hold on to you instead. Help us, Lord, each day to view this life as more of an offering to you and less of our possession, Lord. May we be your servants in all that we say and do. And we thank you, Lord, and we ask it all. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated, and the children are dismissed at this time for kids' worship. One more song about God's faithfulness for today, and the next week we'll do more. Oh, how high would I climb mountains if the mountains were where you hide? Oh, how far I'd scale the valleys if you grace the other side. Oh, how long have I chased rivers from lonely seas to where they rise? Against the rush of grace descending from the source of its supply. 'Cause in the highlands and the heartache, you're neither more or less inclined. And I would search and stop at nothing. You're just not that hard to find. I will praise you on the mountain, and I will praise you when the mountain's in my way. You're the summit where my feet are, so I will praise you in the valleys all the same. No less God within the shadows, no less faithful when the night leads me astray. You're the heaven where my heart is, in the highlands and the heartache all the same. How far beneath your glory does your kindness extend the path? From where your feet rest on the sunrise to where you sweep the sinners past. Oh, how fast would you come running if just to shadow me through the night? Trace my steps through all my failure and walk me out the other side. For who could dare ascend that mountain, that valleyed hill called Calvary? But for the one I call Good Shepherd, who like a lamb was slain for me. I will praise you on the mountain.
my feet on. So I will praise you in the valleys all the same. No less God within the shadows. No less faithful when the night leads me astray. You're the heaven where my heart is. In the highlands and the heartache all the same. And if ever I walk through the valley of death, I'll sing through the shadows my song of ascent. Whatever I walk through, wherever I am, your name can move mountains wherever I stand. And if ever I walk through the valley of death, I'll sing through the shadows my song of ascent, my song of ascent. My song of ascent. From the gravest of all valleys come the pastures we call grace. A mighty river flowing upwards from a deep but empty grave. I will praise you on the mountain, and I will praise you in the mountains in my way. You're the summit where my feet are, so I will praise you in the valleys all the same. No less God within the shadows, no less faithful when the night leads me astray. You're the heavens where my heart is. In the highlands and the heartache all the same.
God, as we worship you this morning, we thank you so much that through your faithfulness, we have an opportunity to experience you in powerful ways. As we join you in your work that you're doing, as you call us to the ministry that you have us to do, thank you. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. This morning, we are going to be camping out a little bit in Jeremiah. Now, for many of us, as we read God's Word, we may focus more on the New Testament. But I want to journey this summer a little bit into maybe territory that you're very familiar with, or maybe you've never read Jeremiah at all. But that's what I'd like to look at this summer. And the summer's going to be unique. We're going to have some great things happening soon. Josh is going to be sharing next week, and I'm looking forward to that. And then also this summer, Kerry Dugan will be sharing with us. And he grew up in our church family, and now he's a missionary in the Dominican Republic. And so he'll be sharing with us this summer. So we'll have some special treats as well. But with Jeremiah, it's a very interesting book. You may or may not know this, but it's the longest book in the Bible. But not if you're counting chapters, not if you're counting verses, but if you're counting words, it's got the most words of any book in the Bible. So it's our longest that way. And during this time period of Jeremiah, a lot of things were going on. There's a lot of things going on with politics. Imagine that. In fact, they were very divided. And a little background of where this division came from. If you remember, we have King Saul, and then we had King David, and then King David had Solomon. And during that time period, the temple was built. And Solomon was known for a very wise person, but also in his life, he did some very not cool things. And talking about, well, do you know who knows the name of Solomon's wife? And some of you are chuckling because you know which one. Well, I heard that from somewhere. So there's hundreds of them. Okay. As Lisa and I work through our marriage and do life together, you know, it's a struggle with one spouse. Can you imagine hundreds? And it led to disaster in a lot of ways. So when Solomon, King Solomon died, he had all these spouses and he had all these children. And ultimately, they begin to fight over control and who is going to control the kingdom. And it wound up, they split. And so the kingdom, as God led people in the promised land and they're living there, unfortunately, they became so divided. And there's a little map there into two kingdoms, Israel to the north and Judah to the south, and having two kingdoms here. And as they had their own kings and time went on, the people in both kingdoms got farther and farther away from where God was calling them to be. And it was, they were both horrible at times, but Israel, the northern kingdom, every king they had, the Bible describes as being bad, leading people farther and farther away from God, doing more and more horrible things, bringing the idolatry that was all around them, bringing that into their lives with practices that range to such horrible things of sacrificing of children. I mean, horrible, horrible things going on that are coming in. And God, through other prophets, were talking to people and saying, you've got to stop this. You've got to come back to me. You've got to stop all this detestable things that you're doing. Judah had a few good kings, but most of them were bad as well. So eventually, right before the time of Jeremiah, God allowed the Assyrian Empire, with this growing dominance within this region, to come in and to take them over completely. And, you know, within a divided state, you got the, could call them the Yankees and the Southerners, but you've got the North and the South. The South, Judah, is like, I can imagine, like, serves you right, you guys. You turned away from God and look what happened to you. And as they continued on and the Syrians only got down to close to Jericho, notice that Jerusalem is in the northernmost part of Judah. It's hard to see, but Jerusalem is at the northern part of Judah. And for the people, recognize what the temple means for them. As they know in their history, whenever the Ark of the Covenant was traveling and when that Ark went forward, it gave the army, you know, a sense of power, and it meant that they always got victory. And so the southern kingdom, the thought is that they've got the temple in their part of the world, and God will never allow an invader to come down past Jerusalem because that's where the temple's at. And so they were counting all their hopes on the fact that the temple was in their country and that represented God, and they were still active in practicing doing sacrifices at the temple. So, but their lives were still a mess. They were doing the practice of religion, but they were leaving God out of their hearts. And they were doing these outward acts of worship, of being involved and doing what God was calling them to do, but their hearts weren't in it. It was very separate. So as we get to the time of Jeremiah, northern kingdom's history, the Assyrians have taken care of that, and we've got Judah, and now God is coming to Jeremiah and saying, I love my people, but they're messing up, and I want you to go and be my voice. And that's where we're going to be here at the beginning of Jeremiah. We know a little bit of the background. I rushed through that pretty quickly, but a lot's going on here. But this is Jeremiah 1:1. The words of Jeremiah, son of Hilkiah, one of the priests, at Anathoth in the territory of Benjamin. The word of the Lord came to him in the 13th year of the reign of Josiah, son of Ammon, king of Judah, and through the reign of Jehoiakim, son of Josiah, king of Judah, down to the 5th month of the 11th year of Zedekiah, son of Josiah, king of Judah, when the people of Jerusalem went into exile. So right off the bat, we're reading here that they didn't listen. And the Babylonians came and eventually took them. But God, knowing this would eventually happen, he's wanting to bring hope to the people through the prophet Jeremiah regardless. So this is God now speaking to Jeremiah in verse 4. The word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as, and this really stands out to me, a prophet to the nations. It's not just saying a prophet to Judah, a prophet to Judah and Israel, to the Hebrew people. But I've appointed you as a prophet to the nations. Alas, sovereign Lord, I said, I do not know how to speak. I'm too young. Does this remind you of anyone farther back in their history? Who does that remind you of? Moses. Yes, because remember at the burning bush and God is calling Moses, and Moses is like, I'm a lousy speaker. I can't do this. So Jeremiah is of that same heart of recognizing, I'm too young, I'm too inexperienced, I'm not a great talker. And he knows this is a big deal. And he knew what happened to the prophets before him as well, and it wasn't good. As they proclaimed the good news, people did not listen. And Jeremiah's like, you need someone better than me, God, than to do this. Have you ever been in that situation? Like, have you been in a situation where you get this little tug in your heart that you need to do something, and you recognize, you know, is that my imagination, or is that from God? And you're pondering, do I really need to do that? And then you start thinking, this is what I do. Start thinking, yeah, I'm no good at that. I'd be lousy at doing that. So it must just be my imagination. God's not wanting me to do that. But if we really understand of God's calling and looking at that, almost everyone that God calls for whatever task within the biblical narrative, rarely is someone gung-ho to go do that. It's scary. It's out of their comfort zone. And they make excuses very often. That's what happens. And I see that in my own life. Do you see that in yours? That neglect of that? But I want to say that's an opportunity. God is wanting to do something to the nations. I heard a story once that reminds me that whenever God calls me to do something small, it's easy for me to blow it off because I don't think it's really that big of a deal, when maybe it's huge and I just don't know it, because God has the big picture in his mind and he understands what's going on. But it was that a guy who was shining shoes talked to all the people that he was shining their shoes on 100 years ago, told them about Jesus and about how awesome Jesus was. And then one of the guys that he brought to Jesus became a minister, and then this minister eventually led Billy Graham to Christ. And just thinking back, when that shoe shiner was sharing his story about God and his life, didn't know that these few words that he was sharing would have such a great impact in the kingdom of God much later. So I want to say that when God talks to you to do something little and we ignore it, we can be missing a huge opportunity, to be a big part of God's plan of something that's going on in someone else's life that we're completely oblivious to and unaware of. But God knows. So my hope is, as we listen to the Holy Spirit this morning, that we will be really challenged, that when God speaks to us, that even though we'll feel very inadequate to do what that nudge is coming, that God's with us. And let's see how God responded to this in 7. But the Lord said to me, don't say I'm too young. You must go to everyone I send you and say whatever I command you. Don't be afraid of them, for I am with you and will rescue you, declares the Lord. And then the Lord reached out his hand and he touched my mouth and he said to me, I've put my words in your mouth. See, today I point you over nations and kingdoms to uproot and tear down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant. You see, God's words aren't simply judgment. He's offering choice. And very often I try to recognize in my own life that life is a lot of choices. You choose this or you choose that. And this has certain consequences, good and bad, and that has certain consequences, good and bad. And we make these choices every day in different aspects. And very often, sometimes we'll make a choice that we've got 15 seconds to make, and if we make the wrong one, it can affect our trajectory in life for the rest of our life. So learning to make good, healthy choices and listen to the Spirit speaking to us is really an important skill to learn and develop as we live life and as we listen to the Spirit working in our lives. And here, young Jeremiah accepts the challenge. And he's accepted God saying, I'll give you words to say, and I will protect you, because he knows what's happened to the other prophets. And he begins his journey. And then let's look on to see one of his first messages to the people in chapter 7, also beginning with verse 1. And here he is standing at the gate of the Lord's house. So he's at the temple. So he's in Jerusalem. And remember, this is close to the border. And he's speaking to the religious leadership. He's speaking to the people that he knows, and he has some very important words for them. This is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Stand at the gate of the Lord's house and there proclaim this message. Hear the word of the Lord, all you people of Judah who come through those gates to worship the Lord. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Reform your ways and your actions, and I will let you live in this place. Do not trust in deceptive words and say, this is the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. If you really change your ways and your actions and deal with each other justly, if you do not oppress the foreigner, the fatherless, or the widow, and do not shed innocent blood in this place, and if you do not follow other gods to your own harm, then I will let you live in this place. In this land I give you, your ancestors, forever and ever. But look, you're trusting in deceptive words that are worthless. Will you steal and murder and commit adultery and perjury, burn incense to Baal? That's one of the neighboring gods. And follow other gods you have not known. And then come and stand before me in this house which bears my name and say, we're safe. Safe to do all these detestable things? Has this house which bears my name become a den of robbers to you? But I have been watching, declares the Lord. Do you understand the mindset of where the people have gotten to in their lives? That they recognize there's danger, because now there's the Babylonians. And the Babylonians are fighting against the Assyrians. And the Assyrians took over that northern country. But now Babylon is the new kid on the block, and he is taking over, and the people are trusting in something to keep them safe. What are they trusting in? They're trusting in the fact that they go to church every Sunday. They're trusting in the fact that there's the temple, and they're not caring where their hearts are at. You see, they're caring that they're going to temple, they're going to church every Sunday, they're offering their offerings like they're supposed to do. But God sees not just what they're offering on their day of worship. He sees what, which is Saturday, he sees what they do on Sunday and Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday and then Friday night. And Saturday night, he sees that as well as the acts of worship. And God's noticing their acts of worship that they're doing when they're gathering together don't align up with their behavior during the week. And the first things that he points out is how they're treating widows orphans, and foreigners. These are the first things that he has Jeremiah challenge them on, and saying, this is showing, these actions that you're doing during the week is showing what's going on in your heart. And it's not good worship. You see, your worship of me isn't so much that you're going to temple, but it's how you're living your life all week long. And as the people hear these words, it's meant to be hope. It's meant to be a challenge. But do we do the same thing? Do we count on the fact that we're a regular attender at church? Do we count on that as that's what makes me a good person, and that means I'm a good follower of God? Or is it what you do every day? And let's just ask ourselves the question, me at my worst during the week, what do other people think about me and think about my faith and think about my God when I'm at my worst? When things are not right at school, when things are not right at work, when we've got a neighbor that we just don't get along with, my actions during that time period, what does that say about my faith? And if someone is watching me, are they learning who God is by watching me? The people during Jeremiah's time wasn't a good picture. It wasn't a good picture at all. I'm going to go back to 9. Will you steal and murder, commit adultery and perjury, burn incense to Baal and follow other gods you have not known, and then come and stand before me in my house which bears my name, and saying we're safe and safe to do all these detestable things? Has this house which bears my name become a den of robbers to you, a den of thieves? Where have you heard that phrase before? I know it sounds familiar, and you're thinking, yeah, I've read that somewhere. It's what Jesus said. When Jesus went into the temple and he was so frustrated and he's seeing all the shenanigans going on, instead of focusing on prayer and God and scripture, he starts quoting Jeremiah when he's seeing this and saying, my father's house has become a den of robbers, a den of thieves, as he's quoting this. There's a lot of significance to that, because Jesus is pointing out to the people during his time period, it's not about a building. And just after this time period, the people who were trusting in a building to save them lost it. See, the Babylonians came and they destroyed the temple. And as Jesus is preaching and challenging the people in a rebuilt temple, he's telling them the same thing. You cannot trust in a building, you can only trust in me. And he's letting them know in his own way that that building would be destroyed too, but also the temple that's in him was going to be destroyed as well. You see, there's only one thing that we can trust in for full hope and permanence, and that's listening to the word of God in our lives through the Holy Spirit and following that. So my challenge for you this morning is to recognize it's not any actions that you do that make you a good person as far as worship is concerned. If you come to church and you pray, that's great, but that's not what is going to save you. You may give a healthy offering, that's not what's going to save you, that act of worship. It's having the God of the universe to invite in and then become who God is calling you to be as you listen to the Holy Spirit, and that you surrender all of your self, your will, your desires, and focus on Christ, and letting then your own personal will and desires to merge with who God is calling you to be. It sounds like when Jeremiah was growing up, it wasn't on his radar screen that he was going to be a great prophet. I bet he was trying to be a godly person as he's growing and learning, but this wasn't probably on his radar screen by his actions here and saying, I'm not worthy of doing that. I'm not a great talker. But he is willing to listen and obey. And for all of us, that's all that we can do, is learn to listen and obey. And so when the Holy Spirit speaks to us and nudges us in things in our own life, whether it's, hey, Randy, you need to start doing this, you need to stop doing that, we don't need to just blow that off and say, you know, I'm saved by the grace of God and I'm one of the redeemed and God always forgives me, so I'm good, and I just keep going forward with blinders on. No, it's really important that we listen and always respond and do what God is calling us to do. Because if we don't, there's consequences. And it may be a consequence that we have to deal with. It may be a consequence that one of our loved ones has to deal with. Or it may be consequences of something that we don't even know. But when God is calling you to something, it's a privilege. Do what God calls you to do. And even if you feel inadequate, you're incapable of doing that, you don't have that discipline, you don't have that talent, you're a lousy speaker, if God's calling you to do something, do it. You will be greatly blessed by that. And not only you, but the kingdom of God will be blessed because of what you're responding to. And it's not an easy task, and it may not be something that you're excited about doing. But listen. Carefully listen. In my own life, I've been shown many times when I don't listen to God, and sometimes I haven't had terrible consequences, but one of the things that God really pokes me hard with is God will ask me to do something, and then I don't do it, and then I see someone else doing it. And I'll mention one in particular that I'm like, God, you're amazing. I had a gentleman from another state he was visiting, and he just wanted to talk to me. And then he described that something that was going on, I think he was from Atlanta, but he said the churches are gathering in his community together, and then rather than going on a mission trip somewhere, they're focusing on doing mission locally. And the youth are doing it, and they work on people's houses locally, and they ask what can they do to help in the community, and they gather together. And it was a huge administrative thing to organize. And he was saying, you know, I just feel like God was wanting me to tell you this. What you do with it is you. I've done my part now as I've shared this with you. And I sat on that for probably 6 months or longer. And then I had my friends at the Methodist Church, at North United Methodist, call me up and say, hey, some of the kids in our youth group have been led to do something that's really cool. And he described what it was to me, and it was word for word describing what he had talked to me about. And I sit on it too long. I didn't say no to God. I just was like, yeah, I'll try to work that in my schedule sometime. And, you know, the Holy Spirit hit me really hard, and I missed that blessing of working on that, and I participated later. But who really got the incredible blessing is those two seniors in high school, these two girls who felt led to do this and prompting their parents to really help with this. And they created Madison Mission Week. And so that's just one example. I've probably got 100 in my lives where I was too slow on the draw on things. But you may hear a calling and it maybe seem too big, or you're too busy, or it doesn't make sense to you. But I want to challenge you to listen and have the courage to respond and just allow God to do really good things through you. And it's not that you need to be super talented or super popular. Maybe no one knows you in town. Who knows? But it may be as simple as a kind word to your neighbor, or it may be developing some huge new big thing. I don't know. But whatever it is, listen to God and be willing to speak. It can have dramatic effects on the kingdom of God. And if God wants it done, it'll happen, okay? But you're going to lose out on participating with that. So I just want to challenge you, listen and obey. we're going to focus on this question. How do I respond to God's calling in my life? Do you ignore it? Do you say, that sounds awesome, I'll get right on that, and then you don't get on it at all? Or maybe you just don't feel worthy of doing it. Or maybe you never feel God speaking to you at all. Wherever you're at, that's where you're at. I want you to think about the next step. Where is it I need to go from here? I'll be standing over here. Eric's going to strum a little bit, and then the band will sing. But during this time period, the point is for you to really listen to the Holy Spirit in your life. Listen to what the Spirit is saying, and then respond. I'll encourage you to respond the way that God wants you to, not the way that you want to. And if you want to talk about that or have me pray with you, that'd be great. I'll be over here. If it's something you just need to respond to within your own spirit, that's fine. Or maybe you want to call me up and talk to me about it later in the week, that's great. But the important thing is that you do what God's calling you to do as we continue worship with our lives and recognize it's what we do all week long. That's what God's looking at, because God's looking at what's here. And I'm so glad you're here this morning and we're worshiping together, and I enjoy that. But that's a piece of what God wants us to do. What God really wants is your heart. God, as we continue to worship, thank you for your presence, for your challenge. And God, may we be who you call us to be as we worship you this morning. And help us to know what it means to listen to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's all stand together. As we sing this song, O Come to the altar is open. If you feel led, you know, maybe something's going on in your life, you just need to bring it before the Lord here, talk to Randy about it. Don't feel embarrassed by coming forward, you know. Just come on. Lay it before the Lord. Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. And have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring us sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior. Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen.
So bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
Jesus is calling.
Wow, what a message.
Thank you.
Amen. That was awesome. I've been attending a Bible study during the week, and the common theme has been that where's the church at today? You know, have we lost spiritualism? What would Jesus do if he showed up at church today? He seemed to be so angry with the people at the time. And I think maybe why he was so angry is they were so steeped in tradition. He was trying to teach them that they needed to get away from that. And it's not that there's really anything wrong with tradition, but we have spirit and we have truth. And we have truth in God's word. And certainly in his spirit. And we're to worship him in spirit and in truth. And man, how awesome that is when we tap into it. And I thank the people that, you know, come to the Bible study. And I thank you for being here today. And Randy, I thank you so much for that message. Man, that was awesome. Thank you.
Thank you, David. So as we leave this building, recognize you are leaving as the temple and as a priest and as a sacrifice as you commit your life to Christ. And may the people who run into you see God and a glimpse of who God is because of your response to the Spirit in your life. God, thank you for this opportunity to be who you call us to be. And may we not be afraid to be and do as you call. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.